and of Grand Admiral Durning, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea, and air forces in Europe to the Allied Expeditionary Force and simultaneously to the Soviet High Command. We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing. Advance Britannia! Long live the cause of freedom! God save the King!
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight is our own VE celebrations and a fundraiser to support Erskine Hospital. We have some great prizes tonight in our raffle and in our silent auction, which we'll speak about later in the evening. All proceeds from the bar will also go to Erskine Hospital tonight, so the more you drink, the more money will head to Erskine Hospital. So please enjoy your drink. So as I thought, can I ask you to enjoy yourself, and can I please ask you to welcome on stage the man who's put all this together, ladies and gentlemen, Glen Ballantyne.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please be upstanding for our top table. Thank you. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. What on earth was I worrying about? You look absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much for dressing up and taking part in our VE Day celebrations. I really can't thank you enough. Can I especially welcome and introduce to you our World War II veterans? Firstly, Bob Rigg. Bob, give us a wave. Bob was called up to the Royal Navy in 1942 and served as a gunner on merchant ships and was in five different continents during the war. Bob sailed convoys in the North Atlantic and brought back troops from Burma, broken men. Bob will be 93 next month. And Bob is accompanied by his son Alistair. You're very welcome. Nan Burns. Nan was a nurse in Aberdeen General Hospital in 1942. And Aberdeen, when I was researching this, I just had no idea this was had happened, but Aberdeen was known as the Siren City during World War II and was the most frequently bombed city in the UK. I'm delighted Nan is here to represent the nurses, of which there are many in the room. Nan will be 90 this year. And is Williamwood Golf Club's oldest playing member. And if weather permits, is still out playing 2 and 3 times a week. And Nan is accompanied by a lifelong friend, Margaret Ralston. Ladies, you are very, very welcome. Archie McCormick. Archie was a gunner in a Sherman tank with the 9th Queen's Own Lancers. After a spell in Algeria, he fought in the Italian campaign. Archie saw his first Rangers game in 1928 and has supported them ever since. That's a hell of a lot of suffering for one man. Archie is accompanied by his wife, Betty, of 61 years. They're a lovely couple. Please give them a big warm hand. And finally, Hugh Maguire. Hugh volunteered to the Royal Ulster Rifles and is a D-Day veteran on Sod Beach in the early hours of the 6th of June. Hugh has been invited to the Queen's Garden Party in June this year, where he'll be meeting her for a second time. The last time he met her was 71 years ago, when she was 18, in the camp just before D-Day in Southampton. Hugh, I'm certain she'll recognise you. On top of all these other medals, Hugh is about to receive France's highest military honour, the Legion d'Honneur, from the French government for his part in D-Day. Hugh will be 95 on the 26th of this month. And Hugh is accompanied by his lovely daughter, Teresa, who's one of Hugh's 7 children. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll be hearing more from our veterans later in the evening. But please welcome one more time our top table. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Ronnie Smith to the stage, who will remind us of why we are here. Ronnie, big welcome, please.
Thank you, Glenn. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and may I offer my personal welcome to you all and my enormous respect for our veterans here this evening. World War II was the bloodiest, deadliest war the world has ever seen. More than 55 million people died. Many of them were innocent civilians, men, women, children, babies. Millions more suffered physical and mental scars for many years after. It was the most destructive war in history. Fighting raged in many parts of the world. More than 50 nations took part in the war, which changed the world and the geography of nations forever. If ever Robert Burns' phrase, man's inhumanity to man, was more evident, then World War II would take mankind to new levels of barbarity, depravity, wickedness and evil. Using science, technology and engineering to kill human beings in the most sadistic and clinical way. Some of the best engineering minds in the world would build factories to murder millions of people and make money from every part of their bodies and belongings. This was murder and theft on the most colossal scale. Railway engineers would build a superb rail system that brought millions of people hundreds of miles in unspeakable cattle truck conditions to their deaths. Eminent doctors like Joseph Mengele, who thought nothing of trying to knit twins together and treating human beings as experiments, discarding them at rags when the experiments didn't work in his dream of building the master race. Some of the most brilliant scientists, headed by, Wernher von Braun, developed the V1 and V2 bombs that were so destructive in attacking southern England, and after World War I, his team would ironically help get the United States to the moon. More threateningly for the world than all of this, Robert Oppenheimer developed the atomic bomb that the US President Harry Truman would use against the Japanese. The successful use of atomic weaponry secured the United States as the absolute and only superpower and took the world to a new and dangerous precipice. So what caused World War II? Germany and its allies had been the losers in World War I. Germany was stripped of 1/6 of its territory and forced to pay huge reparations as a result of the Versailles Treaty. After World War I, Germany suffered from high unemployment and runaway inflation. German money became almost worthless. Many Germans seethed in anger at the Versailles Treaty, no more than Adolf Hitler, who had made it his life's ambition to see Germany supreme in the world. In the early 30s, the world was hit by an economic depression. Workers lost their jobs, trade fell off, times were hard. People looked for leaders who could bring about change. The dictator Mussolini came to power in Italy, and Japan came under the rule of its military leaders. In Germany, Adolf Hitler, leader of the Nazi Party, gained power in 1933. These leaders promised to restore their countries to greatness, but they set up totalitarian governments. Hitler began to arm Germany for war. Japan invaded China. Mussolini sent Italian troops to conquer Ethiopia and Africa. None of the world's democracies did anything to stop them. Hitler had a plan to conquer Europe. He began by taking Austria, then Czechoslovakia. No one tried to stop him. Winston Churchill kept telling the House that war was imminent, indeed inevitable, but he was widely regarded as a warmonger. Despite assurances to Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain from Hitler of peace in our time, the war in Germany began with Germany's invasion of Poland in 1939. Britain and France very bravely declared war on Germany 2 days later. Soon after, France is completely taken over and becomes occupied by the Nazis. Britain stands alone. May 1940, in his first address, Winston Churchill said, "It must be remembered that we are in the preliminary stage of one of the greatest battles in history. I would say to the House, as I've said to those who have joined this government, I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat. You ask, what is our aim? I can answer with one word, victory. Victory at all costs. Victory in spite of all terror. Victory, however long and hard the road may be, for without victory, there is no survival." By this time, all of Europe had been conquered by Nazi Germany. Wherever the Nazis went, they waged a campaign of terror, mainly against Jewish people, but also against other minorities. This was policed by the disgusting and sadistic Gestapo, who who kept an iron grip on the German regime. In occupied Europe, incredible acts of individual bravery by civilians took place, and the French resistance in the Dutch underground gave hope to many, harbouring refugees and bringing food and shelter to servicemen and civilians. The example of Anne Frank is so clear when so many people tried to help and protect her family, and the brutal treatment they all received for their bravery. Winston Churchill addresses the House and warns the Battle of France is over. I expect the Battle of Britain is about to begin. The whole fury and might of the enemy must be very soon turned on us now. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duties, and so bear ourselves that if the British people in its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, then men will still say, this was their finest hour. Almost every family in Britain is now involved in the war. Fathers, brothers, uncles volunteer or are conscripted. Women volunteer for the war or conscripted or pile into factories to make ammunitions or go to the farms to dig for victory. Rationing starts in the UK and the British people become fitter and healthier than at any time before, but they're also constantly hungry. The German Blitzkrieg overwhelms Belgium, Holland and France with burning towns and cities everywhere. Dunkirk. The British Expeditionary Force evacuated from Dunkirk in May and June. More than 338,000 men are brought back from France with every type of sailing craft. Churchill gives a morale-boosting address to the House shortly after. We shall not flag or fail. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France and on the seas and the oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches, the landing grounds, in the fields, in the streets, on the hills. But we shall never surrender. The Battle of Britain is in earnest, and the RAF fight the Luftwaffe 24/7 to defend Britain. And their unbelievable success against all odds forces Hitler to postpone the invasion plans of Britain. Churchill pays tribute to the Royal Air Force with one of his most famous speeches, that never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few. 41, Hitler begins Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of Russia. A fatal mistake of fighting in two fronts against his general's wishes, and makes the same mistake that Napoleon did 100 years before. The Blitz continues against Britain's major cities, including Clyde Bank, where between the nights of March 13th and 14th, the town was largely destroyed and suffered the worst destruction and loss of civilian life in all Scotland. 528 people were killed, 617 seriously injured, and hundreds maimed by blast debris. December 41, Japan attacks a American naval base at Pearl Harbor, and the US enters the war. Germany declares war on the United States. 42, Field Marshal Montgomery and his troops secure an enormous victory at El Alamein in North Africa, which blocked any advances by the Nazis to control the Suez Canal and the riches of the Persian oil fields. In the east, Singapore falls to the Japanese in February, with approximately 25,000 prisoners taken. Mass murder of Jewish people at Auschwitz begins. 43, German troops surrender at Stalingrad, which marks Germany's first major defeat in Russia. The Allied victory in North Africa enables the invasion of Italy to be launched. Italy surrenders to Allied forces unconditionally on the 8th of September. On October 13th, a month after surrendering, they declare war on Germany. As Italy changes from supporting Germany to now supporting Britain and the Allied forces, the joke amongst the British servicemen that you can tell an Italian tank it has one forward gear and four reverse. British and Indian forces fight the Japanese in Burma in horrific man-to-man combat, and Allied prisoners are treated to the most sadistic atrocities, and thousands die in blistering heat with no food or water in building the infamous Burma Railway. 44 major gains are happening in Italy with the capture of the monastery at Monte Cassino, with nearly 5 months of bloody engagement ending in victory. Allied forces also land at beaches near Anzio, Italy, which leads to the eventual capture of Rome and the enormous psychological significance of gaining the city. The Soviet offensive gathers pace in Eastern Europe, and the race to be first to take Berlin is on. D-Day, 6th of June, 44, Deliverance Day, the Allied invasion of France begins, with Paris being liberated in August of that year. 45, Auschwitz-Birkenau, liberated by the Soviet troops, and the world sees the depths the Nazis will sink to achieve world domination. The word Holocaust would enter our vocabulary, with more than 1 million people killed at these two death camps alone. The Russians win the battle for Berlin and triumphantly raise the Russian flag atop the Reichstag. Hitler commits suicide in his bunker, and Germany surrenders unconditionally on the 8th of May, 1945, 70 years ago today. When Churchill, Roosevelt and Stalin met at Yalta in the Crimea, the discussion took place about post-war Germany and how it would be divided and what to do with German military personnel. Stalin proposed executing 50,000 senior German officers. Both Roosevelt and Churchill thought he was joking, but he was not. Perhaps a clue of the future was there for all to see. It was finally agreed that the Nuremberg trials would deal with the convictions. Sadly, Goering and Himmler managed to commit suicide, thus cheating the Allies of the considerable pleasure of putting them to their death. Truman becomes president of the US on Roosevelt's death, and Attlee replaces Churchill at the general election. After the atomic bombs are dropped in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan surrenders unconditionally on the 14th of August, 1945, nearly 6 full years from September 39, and mercifully, World War II finally ends. In summary, Britain had a moral claim in the world as the only nation that stood against Hitler for 2 years. Britain provided the world with a moral compass and leadership against the Nazis at a time when every other European nation had been subjugated. The British servicemen who fought so bravely and were supported so magnificently by the British people forged a unity of purpose and a strength of conviction that made the famous war correspondent J.P. Priestley claim that the British people were at their greatest during World War II. Much has been made of the fact that Britain made an enormous financial price for World War II and took decades to repay the loans. But I believe this misses the point that the British people had high moral values which they were determined to uphold, and they simply couldn't or wouldn't stomach the subjugation or tyranny that the Nazi occupation demanded. To that end, may I finish by stealing a couple of lines from the Declaration of Our Oath, which I hope resonates with the views of the British people during World War II. It is in truth not for glory, nor riches, nor honours that we are fighting, but for freedom, for that alone, which no honest man gives up, but with his life itself. Thank you very much.
It's very easy for these things to pass over, as in the general election has certainly tried its best to do that, but we're here. We're running a documentary all evening. Everybody will get a copy of the movie at the end of this. I started off knowing nothing about this, and no surprise to you, I ended up the director.
Not like
That's me. Anyway, we're going to show you our little documentary about our guests of honour this evening, and then there'll be a short interview with Hugh McGuire and myself, who will tell you the most incredible story you've ever heard. Thank you.
We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall prove ourselves once more able to defend our island home, to ride out the storm of war, and to outlive the menace of tyranny, whatever the cost may be. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. With growing confidence and growing strength in the air, we shall never surrender. We shall never surrender. Never surrender.
I was posted to Beverly in Yorkshire to be assessed. I was there 6 weeks. Then I was sent to Catrick, and then I'd put a few months in Catrick. Then I was sent to Bovington and Dorset, and did all the tank training in Bovington. You had a week in Bovington, tank training, and the next week he marched 7 miles to Lulworth Cove, and they did their gunnery training in Lulworth Cove.
I joined the Navy, called up to the Navy, and I assumed we were sailing on a destroyer or a battleship or something, and I was put into DEMS. I had no idea what DEMS was at all. DEMS was defensively equipped merchant ships. In other words, all merchant ships over 80 foot had armour of some kind to protect them from U-boats or E-boats or aircraft. And that was how I got into that section, so there we are. So I sailed on merchant ships all the time.
When I was 17, I went up to Belfast to join the Navy. Passed all my exams for the Navy. The warrant came for me to go to Portsmouth, but it arrived in the house before I got home. My uncle got a hold of it. He says he's not joining the Navy, he threw it in the fire.
I started nursing, of course, in Aberdeen, and I was in 1942, the City Hospital, which was a fever hospital. We didn't get many service people in, although if they had infectious diseases, you know, we did. It was a big hospital. But when the sirens went off, if you were off Tuesday, you had to go back to the wards. There was a head count of everybody. I don't know why. Well, I suppose everybody didn't know where we were.
We got to Algeria, and we were up the mountains, and I said to an officer there, "Oh, this is not good. This is, I want to join the HLI." And they got away, but I never could join them. And I finished up doing and joining the 9th Lancers in Algeria.
Well, we came back down again to South America, same sort of thing, through the Bay of Biscay and down to Freetown and the coast of Buenos Aires. And then we went down to Tierra del Fuego, right in south of America. That was south of the Falklands, and there was a meat, there was being loading meat down there. And of course the meat, it was so cold down there, you know, sub-zero temperatures. I was down there on VE Day, actually, in 1944, and loaded up there. We came back up to Montevideo, then into a place called Rio Grande do Sul, that's in Brazil, and then to Santos in Brazil, loading more meat, and then back across to join the convoy north.
D-D came along, and the 5th of June, we got into the boats ready for going across the water, and the weather got very bad, very blowy and wild, so they took us off the boats again, and back into this concentration camp, as I called it. Anyway, we tried it again on the 6th of June. This time we were successful and crossed over to land on Sword Beach in Normandy.
There was a lot of girls called up to the forces and that sort of thing, but I can't remember, you know, what I do remember what it was like. It was hard and the food was poor and we had nothing. We really had nothing. Some of the girls smoked. Before we got their salary, there'd be maybe one cigarette and they put a pin in it and it went around everybody just to get a puff of this. But silly things, really silly things. And I had an uncle who was in the, he was a skipper in the trawlers, and they went out to Faroes fishing. But he always took back black stockings. Because my cousin, she was in the Wrens, she needed black stockings the same as me. But just as I say, silly things.
The Sergeant Major lined us up and says, you're going to be a gunner, you're going to be a tank driver, so forth, different ones. And other ones were told, you're going to another regiment over here. You're not needed in this regiment. I wanted to be a driver. He says, I wanted to be a general. But he never got any further than the sergeant major.
MO came round in the morning, how are you doing? I said, not too bad. I've had a shave. I haven't shaved for over a week. But I think I've got some spots on me. He said, well, just a minute, so he had a look. So he went away and came back. He came back with two other guys and they said, we think you've got a slight attack of smallpox. I thought, my God, that's the end. That's the end, you know. So anyway, within half an hour, I was taken away and out of the hospital. Hospital was closed down, the ship was held up sailing. Everybody contacted had to be vaccinated and checked and stuck in this isolated hospital. And it was pretty... I was fed like a fighting cock. I thought this was the Last Supper, you know, the way the, you know, how long have we got to live, sort of thing.
It was a very slow start for us. The Cosbys was on the right-hand side, the Lincolns was on the left-hand side, and we were in the centre. Anyway, we started advancing a bit, and we got pinned to the ground again, and it took us quite a while till we got into Calms Wood, and were there for a week or so. And then we started advancing again out of there. Got the length of the hill 60, overlooking Cannes. And it was here I got wounded. The corporal in the next trench to me got a direct hit and blew to pieces. The blast of it wounded me in the back with shrapnel. And back of the neck, and it got blew out of the trench for about 12 feet. One officer was in the area of the company commander, who was a Captain DeLonghi, a French Canadian. He came running over. I was Lance Corporal at the time, and he shouts over, are you all right, Corporal Maguire? I says, wait till I get my wind back. Well, good God, he says, I never. I thought I'd hear you speak again. And he come and had a closer look at me. He says, get away down to the first aid post. I says, look, sir, I have a wee job to do first. And I need your permission to try it. And what is that, he says? I says, to silence that machine gun post which has been peppering us all morning. So he hemmed me hard for a while. He says, if you get shot, don't blame me. I says, if I get shot, I'll not be here to blame you. Anyway, he did give me permission to go. And I got up crawled, I got behind them. And I got up on one knee and shouted to them to stand up in the air with their hands in the air and their guns threw out in front of them. There was two of them going to have a go at me, but I was too quick for them and shot them. The other two threw their guns out with their hands in the air and they got out, and one of them turned out to be an SS officer.
Off duty, we liked to go dancing, and it was at the music hall in Union Street, and of course a lot of forces there, and there's good bands, and we really enjoyed it. But there was one night we were there and the sirens went off, so we'd all to get out. And of course, it was a blackout, the trams were off, but it was a moonlit night. And you could hear this German bomber because the sound of the engines were different from ours, and you knew it was a German bomber, and we could see it. He was coming right up, very, very low, light up Union Street, and he started firing. So we had to go into the shop doors and water. Never ran so much in all my life.
The tank commander said to me, says, bring your guns round and fight it. What he did, he says, watch this, he says, there's a block there lying on the ground, popping up and down, with pot shots at the tank commanders, because all every tank commander was head was out of the tank, because nothing else was happening. And he's sniping away, as and he's not hitting anybody. So I just put my guns on him, and it's supposed to be a sniper, but he stayed in the same place, where they could have rolled over anyway, on the ground. So I just stayed in an armour piercing shell and let it go. And not unknown judge, one of the tanks was coming around to get him. And that's what he said. He blew his leg off. I said, that's pity, I didn't go higher, I'd have blown his head off.
In free time, you got these bananas for a packet of cigarettes. These guys have huge stocks of green bananas. Of course, you couldn't get bananas at home at that time. So I had a big stock of these bananas, and we got on the train going north. During the war, of course, it was terribly slow trains, hours to get to Glasgow, to, I don't know, about 14 hours or something in the train. And we stopped at Hereford, and we tried to get tea. You see, well, they wouldn't let you have tea unless you had a cup. We didn't have cups. The Navy don't get issued with cups. You don't get issued with cups. The Army got all their gear. We don't get that at all. So I said to the girl, I said, if I give you a banana, a banana? She couldn't really have, she was so I gave her a stock of bananas. She said, you can keep the cup, she says. So we got rid of some of the bananas there, and so doing a good cause. So we got a couple, we had a cup of tea. We didn't even pay for the tea. So anyway, we got home, and in the evening times when we were home, there was a thing, somebody had a serious illness, and bananas was one of the cures. So I got rid of some of them to that, and the girl, she recovered from it, and I don't know what she had, but we got a letter, a very nice letter from the saying, thank you for the bananas, you know. Just a gimmick, really, because bananas were, you know, unheard of during the war.
And I was sent into an hospital in Woking, where I was operated on, and I was then lay there to recuperate a bit, and then was sent up to a place outside Newcastle. To an hospital there to recoup further. And from there I was sent back to Bangor to recuperate further, Bangor Hospital. Then when they thought I was strong enough, they sent me out to barracks in Belfast, where I did a wee bit of training before I rejoined my battalion. And when I got to the battalion, they were ready for crossing the Rhine. So I joined them and ended up at Berlin.
I was in Kolkata on the ship called the Dunera in dry dock, and the gunnery officer was a South African, and he opened the bar, free bar, to all ratings. So you can imagine the state we were in after a crew glass of whiskey. That was on the VE day, yes. That's how we found out about it, when he opened the bar.
I went to York to get that. A debob suit, and I couldn't get a new suit quick enough when I come home. The pink debob suits were brown and grey, and they all had big stripes down them. Oh, I said, no. So I went to First Tailors, I was nearest me in the Paisley Road, and got measured for the suit right away.
VE Day was a special, very special day. I think we'd been maybe looking forward to something finishing. We were told that the war would be finishing soon. And when we did hear about it, there was a lot of hilarity, of course, in the hospital. And after we were finished, whatever time we were off, we went down to the beach. And there was bonfires, quite a few bonfires. But there was music there, and we were dancing, and we went, as I say, went into the sea, freezing, absolutely freezing, but we just all had a good time.
I got the highest award that the Normandy could do, the Medal of Honour. Now I'm looking forward to receiving the Legion Dunmaya and the DSM Distinguished Service Medal.
At 2:41 a.m. at General Eisenhower's headquarters, General Jodl, the representative of the German High Command, and of Grand Admiral Dönitz, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea, and air forces in Europe to the Allied Expeditionary Force and simultaneously to the Soviet High Command.
I'm going to do a short interview. I had the great pleasure, I've met Hugh several times in the process of putting tonight together. He's one of the most incredible people I've ever met. And he told me this story, and I thought I'd heard everything in life. And he's going to come out and tell us it tonight. Please welcome Hugh McGuire.
Down. There were quite a number of us sent over to the new pit, which was called then Wilson Glen.
Okay, so if I could take you, Hugh, the war ended in 45. Yeah. If I could take you forward to 1961, 16 years after the war ended, and your boss at the mine called you into the office, what did he tell you?
He told me to go down the pit and report to Tony Geekis at J5.
So, this guy, Tony Geekis, tell me, Hugh, who was that man?
That man was the SS officer that I captured, and I went down the pit to meet him. I didn't know it was him until I went face to face with him. I looked at him. Oh, he says, we've met again, Tony. He says, me never saw you before. Oh, yes, you did. Let me bring your memory back a few years. I says, do you remember when I kept at that machine gun post and I shot two of your pals, and you and another soldier belonging to you, threw your guns out, as I said, put your hands in the air, and jumped out onto the ground in front of you, and in front of me, and I told you to march in front of me down to our lanes. This you prepared to do.
It's probably the most incredible thing I've ever heard. What did you say to your boss at the time, Hugh?
I went up the pit when I saw him. I wouldn't work under him. I went up the pit to my boss and I told him, I wasn't working under him because this was the SS officer that I captured during the war. There was no way I was working under him. And he says, I was just prepared to go out the door again and say bye-bye to him. But he goes round me and said, look here, I'll give you a job in another part of the pit, which he did.
So thanks for coming up tonight to tell that story. You told it to me, my jaw hit the floor. I couldn't believe you. That the coincidence of that is quite frightening. Can we wish Hugh is going to meet the Queen, as we mentioned earlier, and he's also going to get the Legion d'Honneur from the French government. Can we wish him all the very best for June? Come on, get up, please. Story. Let me tell you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to serve. The band's coming on soon. Keep drinking.
Hey! Recall the Clyde Bank Blitz. We had a bungalow in Netherlea, and in the cellar we had a bed and supports. I remember the supports holding the floor up in case the house was bombed. At least you would have some little means of support. I do remember sleeping with one of my female neighbours, who's only about 8 at the time, so. It was all in the best possible taste. So there was no problem there. But I remember seeing the glow in the sky of Clyde Bank and hearing the bombers going over nightly.
I remember my mum saying to my sister, "Say your prayers, Agnes, say your prayers." And I think that was probably the night of the Clyde Bank Blitz.
My mother and my sister had gone to the theatre in Glasgow. So my father and I went to the pictures, or the cinema, as you would say now, and the notice came up that the warning had gone. So my father said, "Right, we'll go home." So we came out and walked home. And I remember it was as clear as day. There was a full moon. It was so clear. So we walked home, we went into the house and got all our bits and pieces to take into the Anderson shelter in the garden. So we went down there and then waited anxiously for my mother to appear. So eventually she came in, she practically fell into the shelter and she said, "Oh, you're all right, are you all right?" "Oh, yes." But she was more concerned with her fur coat. She'd on her good musk-wash coat. And she, "Is it all right? Is it all right?" So they were more concerned about that, getting into the shelter with her fur coat. But we survived that and the fur coat survived as well.
My mother suffered from claustrophobia, so she was frightened to go down into the area shelters. She would prefer just to be up and open and take her chances up there. All the buildings had been prepared for the bombing. They knew it was going to be happening, and there were nets and everything in front of the windows. And she recounted the story of coming down the staircase and a bomb going off just as she came down, just outside the building, and all of the window came flying in. Was caught in the netting, just seeing all the shards of glass flying about. Mm. Looking out and seeing all the fires and everything over the city and across to Clyde Bank. After the bombing had stopped, she went up to her bed and slept, and then in the morning she came out and walked down the road from the Jordan Hill, and there was a gatehouse at the entrance to the college, and she saw this old woman sitting on a wall and she was crying, and my mother went over and spoke to her and said, "What's the matter? Can I help you?" And she said, "They're all dead. They've killed my whole family." And that woman had lost her children and her grandchildren from a bomb, a stray bomb that was meant for Clyde Bank, obviously, and had hit the gatehouse of the university. And it deeply affected my mother. She was obviously very distressed by it all, but, you know, the old woman was saying, "Why me? Why have I been left? And why have they all been killed?"
When VE Day came, I was 10.
We were all in bed sleeping, and Mum came through and she shouted, "Right, right, 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 kids, get up. The war's over."
I was nursing in Aberdeen. I was in Aberdeen from 42 to 45.
My father worked in the textile trade. He got a union jacket, put it up the front garden, and a neighbour came and said, "Mr. Hawker, do you realise your flag is in the distress? It's upside down."
We knew there was the Prime Minister was going to speak, and we knew there was going to be some celebration. And we all went down to the beach in Aberdeen, and there was bonfires there, and music, and we were all dancing, and I think we went into the sea as well.
So the whole night was just spent going from street to street to street to see all the bonfires and all the people out there. Flags were all over the place.
Every house had bunting hanging outside, Union Jacks. Superb. That was, I was 10. And that's as far as I can remember. It was a good time.
The bells were ringing. We had no bells during the war. The bells were ringing that day.
It was just a fabulous night. And I can remember it as if it was just yesterday.
I think they were obviously very happy and overjoyed that everything was over, but I think they'd been through so much, they just wanted to move on with their lives. They didn't want to think about all the horrors that they'd experienced.
It's a long time before we get back to normal.
Clap, clap.
But I had two brothers, my elder brothers. There was just the three of us. And my elder brother, he was torpedoed during the war, three times during the war. I think that was another film. He was torpedoed three times, and he was a radio officer in the Merchant Navy. And he was discharged as unfit after that. He came home in a dreadful state at 22. Yeah, but he got over that, and he was very quiet. Yeah, but we didn't. He never discussed very much about his experiences at all. My other brother was in the Royal Navy, and he was out in Ceylon, well, it was now Sri Lanka, and he had a lovely war. That's how it went. Yes.
My dad was in the 602 Squadron, and he was very proud of the fact that he did serve with the 602 Squadron. And he was in before the war started in 1936 because it was an auxiliary force. And then the war started, and that was him in until 1945, and he was ground crew. When he was in, pilots of the Spitfires were very vulnerable from the rear, as they had no way of knowing what was coming from behind. My father designed and fitted a mirror above the cockpit, which benefited them greatly. If you look at the Spitfire in Kelvin Grove Art Gallery, you'll see the mirror that he designed there. This just tells briefly some of the things that he did. This tells about within 3 days, the Glasgow Spitfires sprouted rear view mirrors, and they were mounted just above the canopy in streamlined casings designed by Sergeant Bert Simpson, who'd worked in Stevenson's the coach builders before the war. The fighter's worst blind spot was now less of a threat.
It's about my father, James Story Gillespie, who was a Spitfire pilot during the Second World War. He lied about his age when he was about 17 in order to get in there in the first place, very keen to do his bit. So he trained and that's a picture of his squadron when he qualified, and there's a letter of his, he never did anything half-heartedly, he always excelled, so true to his character, he excelled in his training, etc., and became a pilot very quickly. And that's him, there we are, that's him in one of his training flights in his Spitfire. So just amazing, that's him sort of late teens, ready to go to war in an aeroplane, you know, when we think of our kids today, just amazing. So he got the job of delivering mail, taking mail across the channel, mail and important papers, dispatches, etc. So all very discreet, and this time he was taking mail across and something happened to his, this is a newspaper cutting about it, something happened to his engine, so he was losing power and knew that he was in trouble, but he didn't want to end up landing in enemy lines or behind enemy lines and the papers getting into the wrong hands, so he aimed for safer, you know, other ground that wasn't suitable to land on, but it meant that the enemy weren't likely to get hold of the stuff. So he crashed and ended up upside down and had to dig earth away so that he could keep breathing. But one of his arms was totally, his left arm was totally caught, trapped in the cockpit and everything. So it turned out he had broken his back and fractured his left arm in two places and ended up in a spike from his waist right round to here for about 9 months.
My dad, Andrew Lennox, was in the Argyll and Southern Highlanders. Went off to war as a young man at 24. Left my mum with a young baby and another one on the way. And towards the end of the war, something he never really spoke about because I was quite young, but probably as he got older and when he was quite ill, I maybe started getting interested in about his life and asking him stories about the war. And he told me the story in France when he was really scared. There was a lot of heavy artillery, there was overhead planes, and he was so scared. He was a sergeant in charge of a group of men. They were sort of lying on the ground, but he realised that he had to get the men, as he said, over the wall and carry on towards the battle. And at that point, as he was bringing his men over the wall, he was hit. He remembers going down, and the one thing that saved him was my dad was a heavy smoker at the time, and he had a cigarette case in his top pocket with his soldier's book that they carried. He was badly injured, but probably wouldn't have survived the injury had it not been for the cigarette case and the soldier's book. And I actually still have that, which I'm passing on to my sons. With, he had 55 francs, which must have been, maybe I don't know how much that would have been then, ripped, which was in the soldier's book as well.
I don't quite know how it came about, but he did tell us about this experience, how he, in the 8th Army, they were, and he told us about these two Australians, that whether they were camped or wherever they were based, came and asked directions. They were duly given the directions. And my father-in-law, I think, just as a passing thing, said, you know, they're terribly smart and, you know, all put together for Australians. And Father Summer thought, right enough, idea. But however, they did act on it. And further up the road, these chaps were stopped. And they weren't Australians at all, they were Germans.
There was a wee ARP post in Netherlea in a park, which is now part still there, but there was a wee ARP post there where my father went to. And one night he went, wakened to the sirens, went out way down the road, and they met a lady walking up the road, and they said to her, lady, look, there's an air raid on, you better get indoors with an air raid. She says, no, that's the all clear. He'd slept through the thing.
There was also a clip about one time he was asked to take this passenger across the channel with him. So he just followed orders and took this person over. But it turned out later it was like a diplomat guy. So it was all very undercover. And in fact, I think he wasn't actually meant to get over, but Dad just was following orders. So he wasn't aware of just the shenanigans that were going on with getting this guy over, sort of Secret Service type.
Hello, my name's Len Entwistle. I'm here to just say a few words about my father, Albert Entwistle, who was involved with the Second World War. He was a farmer, soldier, conscript. Then he went back to being a farmer and eventually a steel buyer. He sadly passed away in 1996. He was born in 1920, so he was just the right age for the Second World War. He was the youngest of three farming brothers, and my grandfather actually offered to arrange for my father to farm on a different farm so that he would have a reserved occupation. However, my dad decided to apply to the Royal Navy, but was conscripted to the army. So I don't know whether that was second choice, but anyway, he was in the army. And 1940 saw him in Derby and Lambourne for basic training. One of his little anecdotes was he was told to strip a Bren gun down, and the RSM told him, "You're not milking a something cow, Ent whistle." So, yeah, I remember that one. He was in the Sherwood Foresters. Commanding officer was a guy called Redmayne, and that was part of the 8th Army. He came back with 5 medals, Africa Star, Italy Star, 39, 45 Star, the Defence Medal and the War Medal. He then sailed from Gourock, not too far from here, to Durban in South Africa on a US troop ship, where he was treated to some ribald comments from US Navy along the lines of being a goddamn limer. Then he wasn't sure where he was going to finish up. He thought maybe he was going to go to Malaya, Burma, but in fact went to Egypt. And then a little bit later, the guns went off at El Alamein on the 23rd of October 1942. My father was a truck driver, so that was quite interesting, driving along the desert, trying not to fall asleep, things like that, because it was very hot, but freezing in the evening. He did actually manage to get quite a good job in the officer's mess as a cook. And he did quite a bit of improvisation, making cheese straws out of next to nothing, managing to salvage the sugar after a can of petrol had tipped over in the back of the truck and got into all the sugar bags. And I think he quite enjoyed it, actually, being sort of cooking rather than having people shooting at him. Although, having said that, he did tell me about once he was driving the truck and the guy who was sitting in the passenger seat actually did get shot. So, and he remember one of the things that sticks out in my mind that he told me about was one of the turning points was the US involvement when they supplied so many tanks on the desert, endless supplies of Sherman tanks coming up the line. From there he went to Sicily, and then Anzio Beachhead on 22nd of January 44, and that was pretty terrifying for him. Lost quite a few friends there. I can remember going on holiday in 1970 to Rome and Sorrento, and we visited the graves at Anzio. He did enjoy it. He quite enjoyed Italy, actually. He could speak a little bit, which is quite good for a farmer from Lancashire. And he could actually say in Italian, I've not got it in Italian, but he could say in Italian, "The Germans have taken everything." He did feel sorry for the Italians. And then after Italy, he ended the war in Palestine as part of the peacekeeping force. And then he was demobbed in 46.
My grandfather's cards home to my grandmother from the First World War, and they're just very, very poignant, sweet messages, because of course they didn't have mobile phones or Skype or telephones even. They were just a million miles away and so little communication, but it's amazing having come across going through my parents' belongings, discovering so many letters to each other, both my parents and my grandparents, and just so personal and so touching that we don't have because we're in a different era.
Okay, I'm going to go for this. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to vote of thanks this evening. This sort of thing does not happen without a lot of help from many, many people. Can I first thank Jan Ballantyne? Yeah. I've been driving her mad for 33 years and she's still with me. I want to thank my sister Sheila for selling tickets. And I especially want to thank my brother-in-law Ronnie for one of your best speeches I've ever heard, and a lot of work went into that, let me assure you. And there are very few people in life who deliver a speech like that, so Ronnie, thank you so much. And just as your backside collapses, who do you phone? Les Conn. Where is Les? Les took so much pressure off me in trying to put this together. I can't tell you. He did a fabulous job. And Les, I really can't thank you enough. You've been an absolute star. Thank you. And to the three gay barmen. I think I've drank more than the bloody self looking at the bloody year that do that. But where is Irene and Susan? Look, this hall, I've driven my staff completely crazy. You have no idea the effort the staff at Centurion Signs have put into putting this hall together. And they're not all of them are here tonight, and they have put their heart and soul into this. So I thank them from the bottom of my heart. There are too many numerous people to mention who couldn't make it tonight but donated serious sums of money. People sent cheques, gave cash, did all sorts of things, and just because they couldn't make it, but they thought it was such a worthwhile cause. And to all of them, I thank them enormously.
Ladies and gentlemen, please. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure we all agree that vote of thanks tonight is incomplete. The bringing together of tonight's event just does not happen. It's an old cliche, but it doesn't, like I tell you. There's a lot of planning takes place. And tonight you can see the successful outcome that planning has done. I know when Glenn phoned me up and said, can I help? Can I do this? Can I do that? I knew it would be two things. There would be no holds barred. And there'd be no half measures. You can see for yourself there was neither. Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask you please be upstanding, put your hands together, show your appreciation to the man who made such a successful event. It's Glen Ballantyne.
I forgot to thank our top table. Can I honestly tell you, when you see the full documentary that's going out, we could only show a very small snippet of the stories. Listening to Bob and Nan and Archie and Hugh, the life stories are quite frightening. We talk about austerity. My God, we don't know what we're talking about. But just meeting these people for me was a marvellous pleasure, so thank you.
must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say, I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by. Moonlight and love songs, never out of date. Hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man, and man must have his mate. That no one can deny. Still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.